Begin with a few mantras of chanting of Keno Upanishad. Many of us may not be familiar with the way of chanting, so you may just follow the chant.
Keneshitam patate preshitam manah kena pranah prathamah praiti yuktah केनेषितां वाचमिमां वदन्ति चक्षुश्रोत्रं कौ देवो युनक्ति श्रोत्रस्य श्रोत्रं मनसो मनो यद्वाचोह वाचगो सौ प्राणस्य प्राणः चक्षुषश्चक्षुरतिमुच्य धीरा प्रेत्यास्माल्लोकादमृता भवन्ति न तत्र चक्षुर्गच्छति न वाग्गच्छति नो मनो न विद्मो न विजानीमो यथैतदनुशिष्यात् अन्यदेव तद्विदितादथो अविदितादधि इति शुश्रुमपूर्वेषां येनस्तद्व्याच चक्षिरे यद्वाचानभ्युदितं येन वागभ्युद्यते तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यन्मनसा न मनुते येनाहुर्मनोमतम् तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्चक्षुषा न पश्यति येन चक्षुगोषि पश्यति तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्छ्रोत्रेण न शृणोति येन श्रोत्रमिदगो श्रुतम् तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यत्प्राणेन न प्राणिति येन प्राणः प्रणीयते तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते
See, the highest knowledge known to mankind is given in the Upanishads. In the very good old days, we do not know when certain seekers were in quest of truth, they went all the way up to a master who may be seated in a Himalayan jungle, reveling in the bliss of solitude all by himself. To him, the disciple with all reverence posed this question as to who that God is, what that reality is. The answer was given in three words, Tattvamasi. Tattvamasi refers to the ultimate truth in terms of you are that. Tat means that. Tvam means you. Asi are. You are that. He is asking what the truth is, what that reality is, what that transcendental being is. See, you have to remember the preparatory qualifications necessary for a Upanishadic student. We have studied Bhagavad Gita in detail. Bhagavad Gita is also the essence of the same Upanishads. But the situation in which Bhagavad Gita was given is different. The situation in which Upanishads was given to Upanishad student is different. In Bhagavad Gita, the Brahma Vidya or the knowledge of the self was given according to the circumstances which was forced at that point of time. Why Bhagavad Gita we are able to relate to more easily? Because the listener or the shrota or the disciple or the student of Bhagavad Gita is Arjuna, who is representative of most of the people at most points of time. The first chapter of Gita shows the condition in which Arjuna was there, and in that condition, to revive him, Bhagavad Gita was given. Not that all of us are depressed at all points of time, but all of us go through the bouts of depression. We are not at the very peak of our spirits, which is the original nature of happiness at all points of time. We go through high and low. And Arjuna's condition before Bhagavad Gita represented a stalwart, a great hero, a commander-in-chief, leader Arjuna had fallen to the depths of depression. This is what is shown in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita. So what it means is, that condition of Arjuna can affect any one of us. It can come to any one of us. So therefore, to revive him, Krishna had to give the Bhagavad Gita. Again, the starting of Bhagavad Gita in point of view of Krishna's lecture in second chapter is pure Upanishad, Brahma Vidya, where it only starts. But here is not Arjuna who was a mumukshu. Mumukshu means a person who is fired by the idea of self-realization. That is, fired by the idea of I want to liberate myself. There is an intense desire for liberation. Before we studied the Tattva Bodha gives the qualifications of a student who can study Tattva Bodha. In that he says, Mumukshunam Hitarthaya. It is given for Mumukshus. Mumukshus are those who are having an intense quest for freedom. See, when we say freedom, imagine a person who is in a prison. And let us say that prison has all the facilities for him. It's like a golden prison, let us say. He is given all the facilities and amenities that he wants. And he is enjoying himself. There is people at his beck and call, there is television all the time, there is a place for his walking or jogging, everything is there. Food is there at his command, everything is there. So it seems to be a very, very comfortable life. And he is okay with it. Okay. But suddenly at one point of time he realizes all this is there and he is enjoying, but still he is confined to a place where he feels restricted. It is not his original movement or freedom is not there for him. The moment he realizes that, however much he may be in comfort, the thought will be always there, when I will get out of this? Because he doesn't belong there. He has been forcefully put there for whatever reason. He has forgotten that, but he has been continuously enjoying this. But there an awareness comes that I do not belong to here. Once that thought deeply enters him, he will not rest content till he liberates himself out of the jail, because he does not really belong there. His original position is not there. Think of a mouse which is running towards some cheese or something which is kept in a trap. It is enamored by the food there and it gets into the trap. The moment the trap closes and the mouse knows it is not now very much interested in eating what is there. It is desperately trying how to get out of it. So therefore, the moment we understand the limitations of this world and what best the world can offer also, however best it offers, it is still in the realm of the world. So what is beyond that? And then he understands that it is something beyond where I belong to, there I must reach. Once that fire sets in, that is called as mumukshatva. Mumukshatva is one of the qualities required for a spiritual seeker to enter into deeper imports of Upanishadic content. So it is not that if that is the case, all of us are disqualified to study Upanishad. The point is, we have to develop the qualities to the extent possible. If we develop the qualities to the extent possible, then the study of Tattva Bodha, Upanishads, everything makes more sense. Otherwise, it will be just one more theory that we will get into, and we'll have a intellectual satisfaction about certain formulas and theorems that are given here. That is why last class we concluded that Indian philosophers are never content by mere theoretical enunciation alone. It is just an intellectual satisfaction that we are not content. It is only half work done. It must get converted into our practice, our pursuit, and then finally culmination of experience itself. It is the experience that we seek forward to. So therefore, that intense quality, intense aim to liberate oneself is mumukshatva, is a necessary qualification for a student who is seeking this knowledge. In the case of Arjuna, we cannot put him in that category. Though he was a very dharmic person and he was a unselfish ruler, all that warrior, every other thing is there. And he was supposed to fight a dharmic war, in which angle, in which he took a personal angle and he got into depression. So, Bhagavad Gita is the message of the Brahma Vidya, but that is given to an adhikari who is supposed to take in the knowledge out of sheer force of circumstance. Now, you have to picturize the Upanishadic student. He is not under pressure like that. He is not depressed or he is looking forward to any solace in life. In fact, when we come to Mundaka Upanishad, the fourth of the Upanishads chosen by Swamiji, you will find that there he gives an extensive qualification of student also. Parikshalokan karmachitan brahmana, he says. He who has finished the karma, he who has verified what the world can offer, and then he is a Brahmin. Brahmin means who is a seeker here. We are not talking about any birthright, but a sattvic content in a person, in when it is very high, he is seeking something beyond, an inquiry. That inquiring mind is referred to as a Brahmin here. Therefore, here is a person who is fired by knowing the truth, and that fire is there from within. That pushes him. That is the basic difference between a seeker of what we are normally represented by Arjuna and where the Upanishadic student is. What is interesting is, the guru of Bhagavad Gita is Lord Krishna, who is considered God himself incarnate. We believe in this avatar concept in Hinduism. In Upanishads, in some Upanishads, like that, God himself gives the knowledge. In some Upanishads, we do not know who the guru is, who the student is. In fact, it is the depth of self-realization from that experience what pours out is the Upanishad. Interestingly, two Upanishads that we have here, Keno Upanishad and Ishavasya Upanishad, the Upanishads' names are coming from the word Kena and Ishavasya. They are the first letters. So we do not know who the guru is, who the student is. We know what part of the Vedic Shaka and all it is placed. That's about all. That is the greatness of the Upanishadic masters. You will find in the mantras that we are going to read, an extreme humility you will find in their approach to the subject. They give out the truth which in no angle, nowhere in any scriptures in the world has given, and yet they attribute with all humility that is what they have learned from their masters. That is what they have learned from their masters. And that is why you find that same humility in Krishna, where he quotes the rishis of the Upanishads directly. So the guru of the Upanishad is a self-realized master. You have to picturize that sitting all alone in Himalayas, reveling in the truth, nothing else. To him, the student takes all the risks because he may not even know whether he will meet one or not. He takes all the risks through the jungles, and when he meets him, he submits himself in due reverence and surrender, and then poses this question as to what that reality is. So in the good old days, it is said that three words were given as the answer, that you are the truth. Tat Tvamasi. That's all. The course was over. The whole lesson was over. It is for the student to come back and think about it, contemplate about it, and find out the truth. That is probably the best form of education. It is making us think and evolve, going through the process of negation and assertion and various process of reflection and contemplation within us. After a certain amount of contemplation, the student is said to have arrived at some conclusion as to what the truth is, because he said, you are this. And then he goes back and submits to the master with all joy and humility again, is this the truth? The master only says, Neti. Neti means not this, not this. That's all. That is the help that he gives. The only help that he gives is to say not that. Again he goes back and puts in more effort, and then goes deeper into his personality to find out the next level of answer. Again he goes back and submits to the master as to whether this is the truth. He has found out something. Again he says, no, not this, Neti. Three times, four times this happens. After which it is said that student doesn't come. Not that he is fed up with the master. He has found out the truth for himself. He has realized the truth. Imagine such a way of education where it is given. Swami Ramtirtha says, he is very much for advancement of science, technology and every field of activity that is required. In every field we must constantly improve our knowledge base. But he says, those who are supposed to do that, let them do. Indians whose real inheritance, your wealth is this Upanishads, you must get into this. Once you get into this and gain this knowledge, every other thing becomes easy. Not just it becomes easy, the value that you will find in this, other things are definitely secondary. So Indians must not lose this wealth. Not just Ramtirtha, various Western philosophers and thinkers, they have said this. He said, for the sake of the world, the Indians should keep to this knowledge. When everywhere everything is in a depressive mood and other thing, they look forward to spirituality in India. And if we lose this knowledge, where is it gone? It is just not possible that it is kept in books and CDs and Google. It will not help that way. It is a living wisdom through unbroken chain of Guru Shishya Parampara. It is through human source that it can be maintained. That's what he lays emphasis on. So Swami Ramtirtha lays a great emphasis on Indians getting into the knowledge of Upanishads. Now, the circumstance of Gita is different. The circumstance of Upanishad is different. So we have to attune yourself as much as possible towards through the sadhana and other things, so that we get the import of the Upanishad. Much later, when the sharpness of the intellect and the intensity of the mumukshatva was not as much as before, then it is said three words were not enough. Centered around the three words, Upanishads were produced. Upanishads are great texts, cryptic, talking about the knowledge of Brahman only, but it is some are in prose form, some are in poetry form. So the Upanishads came much later vis-a-vis compared to the three words that were given as Tattvamasi. No, Upanishads gave the truth and people were able to grasp the truth through the knowledge of Upanishads. Many thousands of years later, Upanishads were not understood because they became very cryptic. The frequency with which Upanishad was transacted between the Guru and Shishya, that was not present in the later stage. So many thousands of years later, it was Lord Krishna who gave out the Bhagavad Gita. You can say Krishna or Vedavyasa, whoever it is. At that point of time, Bhagavad Gita was to be given out. Bhagavad Gita is the essence of Upanishad only. Now, Bhagavad Gita is a detailed text compared to Upanishad. It is 700 verses. Now, if you say the entire wisdom is confined in just 700 verses, if you master the 700 verses, everything is there. But 700 verses of Gita vis-a-vis Upanishads is a very detailed message. What is karma, karma yoga, third and fourth chapter? I mean, Krishna blows his lung out to explain what it is. Upanishad dismisses karma in one mantra. That is how it relates to. It is not to demean karma. Please, there are various Upanishads which give a elaborate karmakanda also. It is just to make us understand the frequency with which they relate. The Nishkama karma that he is mentioning about is what he knows. Otherwise, there is no need for karma to the level of student that Upanishad is. Therefore, much later to Upanishad was the Bhagavad Gita. Now, Bhagavad Gita itself is attributed to 5,000 years back. And much later, Bhagavad Gita became difficult to understand. The level of the intellect was not of that sharp quality to grasp the import. Therefore, Adi Shankaracharya and various other acharyas had to bring out the commentary on Bhagavad Gita. What is Bhagavad Gita saying? Because there are certain terms that Arjuna and Krishna use, which was very frequently used probably at that point of time. Later, that was not in vogue. Therefore, to explain that and make Vedanta in a very simplified way, Adi Shankaracharya wrote the commentary, not only the commentary on Gita, Prakarana Granthas, what we covered as Atma Bodha, Tattva Bodha, these are all Prakarana Granthas, we say. Prakarana means, Karana means instrument. Prakarana means a good instrument. Instrument is a key. So, the key to the treasures of Upanishads can be opened only through these granthas. That means once you master the basics, then it becomes easy to get into Gita and Upanishads. So, these were all produced much later, but the theme is the same. It is just that the level was up to our level. Great compassion of these masters, we must say, that they brought it to our level to make us understand. Now, much later, these Prakarana Granthas are not understood. Mainly, first of all, the language of Sanskrit itself is out of circulation. No doubt, most of us, when it is said, we can understand because almost all Indian languages are born of Sanskrit and high percentage of Sanskrit is there in Marathi, Hindi, Bengali, in all languages. Even the most distant language like Tamil also has a lot of Sanskrit words. Not to talk of Telugu, Malayalam and Kannada and other things. So, it is there. But the way the grammar and the construction and the richness of it is diluted and we cannot approach even these directly. Therefore, it was the great masters like Swami Ramtirtha and Vivekananda and other people, they brought the same knowledge to our level in a language that we understand. Therefore, Vedanta in its practical form was introduced. Therefore, everybody could relate to Vedanta. So, it is not only meant for a few who can relate to at the very highest level. You start practicing Vedanta in your homes, in your place, in your office, everywhere. Then you slowly get into that rhythm of it, in the frequency of it, so that you can reach the knowledge of the self also. This is the great help of these masters. So if you will find, when our Swamiji's book Vedanta Treatise is there, it is the essence of the Upanishad. The last chapter of this book is Tattvamasi, that the what, that is the theme. But it starts from part A, what is world, what is body, what is mind, what is intellect, from there it starts. Then what is emotion, how to do action. So step by step it is taking us towards this. So the, it is like Upanishad is the cow, milk is Bhagavad Gita. So milk is applicable for all, Bhagavad Gita is applicable for all. But in the modern day, if a child refuses to drink milk also, then what do? You have to make it into ice cream or something like that. It is like that only. We do not know. 500 years later, some commentary to Vedanta treatise may be there to make us understand the ABC of whatever it is. It all depends on how the situation arises at that point of time. Great masters will come, that will work will carry on. Now, it is interesting to note that we talk about a deterioration of the sharpness of human intellect. But from other angle, if you see, in a way in which the intellect also progresses, in the sense, see, in the, there is a book called The Fall of the Human Intellect, which is recommended as a basic book by Swamiji before the study of Vedanta Treatise. I think there in the second chapter, he talks about various stages of evolution of human intellect. This is applicable both at the individual level and at the macro level. Macro level means at the society level, at the world level. Remember, microcosm and macrocosm are similar. They only differ in magnitude. Magnitude means they differ in size only. Otherwise, microcosm and macrocosm are the same. For example, a drop of water is microcosm, ocean is macrocosm. All the qualities of the drop of water is the same as the quality of the ocean. Here also it is H2O, there also is H2O. Here also a sun will be reflected, there also sun will be reflected. Here the reflection of the sun will be very small, there it is very big. That's all is the difference. Otherwise, there is no difference between a drop of water and a big ocean. If you look at the ocean from the cosmos, it is just a drop actually. The whole world is just like a drop. It's the same thing. So it is only the magnitude that is different. The quality remains the same. So therefore, whatever we see as the stages of development in a particular individual, it is the same at the macro level also. At one point of time, again we do not know when we were all cavemen or very aboriginal person who had just evolved into a human being, let us say, that age that they pass through is called as the age of perception. Age of perception means you only see, you only hear. There is no reaction or understanding or anything like that. There is no emotions about it. It is just the transaction with the world through senses. That is called as the age of perception. They saw thunder, they saw lightning, they were living in a cave, they don't know what it is. They just lived by instincts as how animals might have lived. That is the primitive stage of a human development. Much later came the age of superstition. In the age of superstition, little beyond perception, human emotions were developed. And he operated based on the superstitions of the mind. There is no logic or reason involved there. A black cat will cross and you will fail in business. There is no scriptural sanction or any thinking or anything for it. Why and how it came, we do not know, but even today people believe it. So therefore we see there are some people who live in age of superstition even now. So there was a time when probably a majority of humanity lived in it. A big portion of the society lived in it. leaves will rustle and something will happen, so you connect movement of trees to something else. These are all unconnected things, but the mind tends to connect. So this is the age of superstition. Much later came, we do not know, again many centuries later, came the age of scientific enquiry. In scientific enquiry, men began to think, what is the reason for rain? What is the reason for change in climate? What is the reason for sun, moon, all these celestial bodies? Why is object coming down towards earth, not flowing up? So therefore they came to a conclusion, there is law of gravity. Various laws were unearthed by their deep thinking, by their enquiry, etc. So there is a scientific way of relating cause and effect. That is the next stage of evolution. And then we have entered an age, the fourth stage, which is called as the age of contemplation. Age of contemplation is, now we are familiar with the laws. That law of gravity says every object will be drawn towards the earth at 9.8 meter per second square is a law. This we have understood and unearthed in the previous stage. But then the next inquiry comes as to who fixed it at 9.8. Not 9.9, not 9.7, and it meticulously functions at 9.8 every time. Who fixed that two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen should combine to form a molecule of water? Not 3, not 1, but it is 2 and 2 plus 1, and it functions meticulously. So all the laws of the life which functions meticulously, be it pertaining to physics, chemistry, biology, economics, maths, whatever be the subject, each and everything follows a meticulous pattern of law. Law governing, governed by the function of cause and effect. So the next stage of inquiry came as to who is doing all these laws, who is making these laws, who is making these laws function meticulously. No answer can be found out, but there is a deep contemplation about it. And that is the stage where inquiry starts in the truest sense. Inquiry as to who is maintaining all these things. We do not know. We may not arrive at a very proper conclusion also. But the inquiry is still on. The thinking is still on. He goes deeper within his personality to understand what it is all about. That is called as the stage of contemplation. Now, as I said, this can be talked about in the macro level. This can be talked about at the micro level. You go through the stage of a human being. When he is born as a child, as a helpless child which has to be taken care by the parents, at that stage, the child is going through a phase of perception. It is only seeing. It is only hearing certain noise. It doesn't know what it is. It doesn't know what a bad smell and good smell is. The child doesn't know what is right and wrong. The child doesn't know what is emotion. It is just born and it is just observing the world through its senses. Later, when it grows as a child, slowly the emotions start developing. That is why in this country, means it's universally true that as the child gets into the age of 5, 4, 5, etc., when its emotions start to develop, slowly, first bhakti has to be introduced to the child because it is the emotions that develop before the intellect. In that stage, a right type of emotions has to be introduced through samskar, through parents, through teachers, whatever it is. But it is the mind that develops. Later, the intellect develops. He is into the third stage where he asks questions. Why is this? That's why you must encourage the questioning aspect of the child. It is that which makes the child think. Only by original thinking is the intellect developed. And it is by thinking and gaining answer will the emotions be sustained in the proper direction also. Otherwise, beyond a point, if you say do's and don'ts to a child at the age of when it enters teenage, they will rebel against whatever you say and they will say, you go your way, I go my way. What is to be encouraged is the questioning aspect of the child, and then he enters into the scientific inquiry, understanding the laws. Then a stage comes as to thinking about what these laws are all about, how is it functioning, who is making this function, is there somebody called God, who is this God, whether he is within me or without me, how do I meet him, how do I find him. This sort of an inquiry, when it sets in, ideally it should go. Ideally, I am not saying that everybody automatically goes into that stage, but when the inquiry sets in, it is not that each and everything in the world that you, now you have Google, now you have various sources that you will find out everything, that's impossible. If you are alert enough, even with the knowledge that is available, you have to go into the substratum of all that knowledge. That substratum inquiry is the inquiry of the fourth stage. So this happened, you can say, at a group level, it happens at the individual level also. If you take Europe, scientific inquiry was a stage where a lot of scientists were born. 15th, 16th century, 17th century, you find a lot of mathematicians, a lot of scientists, a lot of astronomers, various people came. That's the age of scientific inquiry as far as Europe was concerned, Renaissance period. Before that, there was a lot of superstition. Witches were burnt, on what basis? What is the root cause of it, we are not going to know. But they went through an age of superstition. We are talking about a particular set of people in Europe. Like that, various communities have also gone through at various points of time. Age of enlightenment should come. When and it will come, we do not know. But the age of enlightenment is what we are talking about as the contemplation, where they have to get into the study of Upanishads and find out the truth. Now, on one hand, we see that we talked about deterioration of intellect, which is not able to grasp the three words, Tattvamasi, then we came to Upanishad, then you come to Bhagavad Gita, then you come to commentaries on Bhagavad Gita and Prakarana Grantha and now Vedanta treatise, whatever, there is a order in this. On the other hand, we talk about perception and then superstition and then scientific inquiry and contemplation on a reverse order like this. Seems contradictory, but it is not so. As I said, there can be cycles within a bigger cycle also. And what is applicable for a particular society at one point of time, the other society might have gone through in a different stage also. So it is not, the formula is the same, but it could be applicable at different points of time to different sets of people. See, it is not that we lack the intelligence or intellect of our forefathers. We do have. It also can be interpreted as the energy and the direction of our sharpness, of our thinking, etc., have taken a different angle. You go to your own grandmother's era, age, or great grandmother's age, if you can remember. They might not have been as, within brackets, I am saying, within quotes, as literate or educated as you now. But if you ask them what the time is, by feel of the sun, they will say what the time is. They'll say it is 10 o'clock, 9 o'clock now, just by the feel of the sun. Later generation could just see the shadow and say the time. Sunlight that falls into your house, with that sunlight they will be able to say the time. Later that was not known. You have to put a pole and mark the shadows, so by seeing that you saw the time. Then came watch. What is the time, etc. Sometimes they even see it wrongly and say what the time is. Now it is not that your intellect has gone down or something. What has happened here? Why were the grandmothers able to say? Anybody?
Didn't have the luxury of having a watch. So, and
So if your watch is taken out of you, you will say the time by...
It's a conditioning also.
That's what? How that conditioning came?
All the life cycle and everything was associated with that.
Associated with?
The sun.
With
the... So they were living a life of in tune with the nature. Even today you will find, when the tsunami came in 2004, many human deaths were reported. But in Andaman, the original tribes who are still living there, of them, not many deaths were reported. Other tourists and other people who went to Andaman, they were killed or they have gone through extreme tragedy. They were sensing the tsunami much before. They went to higher places. That is a very interesting case study. Similarly, various animals know when an earthquake comes, when a tsunami comes, or various other thing comes by instinct. So, how does the animal know? Does it have any, it has not studied seismography or any other field of science. But instinctively it knows certain things. That power is there particularly for that particular animal, it is there. Certain insects have, ants know, dogs know certain things like that it is. Animals have no choice but to be in tune with nature. Animals' life is like that. It is pre-programmed, conditioned in such a way that it will be in tune with nature only. It cannot go here or there. The way of life of our ancestors was like that. A human being has to consciously do it with the awareness, with intellect. And they were living like that by and large. So they were able to say. Now, the invention of watch is also intellect. That you can calculate the revolution of the earth around the sun and put it precisely to one macro second. To that extent you can do a calculation is also intellect. That intellect which was attuned to reality in the past, slowly the direction turned towards the world. That's all it is. The various buildings that we put up, various businesses we do, everything involves intellect. Everything involves thinking. We cannot deny that we possess any lesser skill. It is just that the attunement towards the direction of the self has taken a different angle now. So therefore we call it as in terms deterioration of intellect. We must not take it that we lack the capacity or ability to understand what is given here. Therefore, what is required of us is to attune ourselves more in terms of the law of nature, then we will be able to understand the purport of what is given in the Upanishad. Because after all, what they are giving in Vedanta is nothing but laws of life, nothing else. That is why all the people all over the world, they praise Upanishads, Vedanta as a universal religion. What is given is here is Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana means eternal. Dharma means principle. So what is given in the Upanishad is Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana Dharma, eternal principles are those which are applicable at all points of time, to all people, to all places, to all geographical locations, irrespective of wherever you are, whoever you are, whether you are a Christian or a Hindu or a Muslim, whether you are an Indian or a Japanese or American, whether you are man or woman, whether you are literate or illiterate, there are certain laws that govern your inner world that will not change. Now these laws, when it is applied to a particular set of people in particular geographical location, that is called as a smriti. What Upanishads is talking about is shruti. Shruti is not changed, it is sanatana. Smriti is something like Bhagavad Gita is also categorized under smriti, because what Krishna is telling Arjuna is for an adhikari of Arjuna's caliber. The verses that we chanted now, five verses that we chanted in the beginning, Nyayasya Nitya Sanyasi Yonat Veshtina Kankshati. Before that he says, what is this Arjuna is asking in the first question is, Sanyasam Karmanam Krishna Punar Yogam Cha Shamsasi Yachraya Etayor Vekam Tanme Bruhi Sunishitam. Third chapter, similar question he asked. He says, I am confused. You are praising knowledge at one point of time. But you are asking me to go into action, that too a Gorakarma. Gorakarma means killing action. What should I do? Please tell me, he says. Then Arjuna, Krishna gives a set of verses in third chapter, Karma Yoga. Continued with a subtler karma in fourth chapter he gave. After that, now he is asking, please tell me again. You are praising karma, you are praising sannyasa. What is it that is good for me? Tell me in one word. Please tell me, he says. So Krishna goes on to say, both are same, both are going to take you to the self, but Karma Yoga is better. Karma Yoga is better, and very clearly, categorically he says. The question arises as to Karma Yoga is better for who? Karma Yoga may be better for most of us, majority of us. But if you take inherent value of a sannyasa and inherent value of a karma, sannyasa is much, much superior and subtler. That doesn't mean Krishna is bluffing. He is talking to a adhikari whose adhikara is mainly for karma yoga. That is why he reconciles and say, ekamapyastita samyak ubhayor vindate phalam. Even if you get established in one, you get the fruit of both. So, a railway track which is going from here to Chennai, let us say, somebody is near Chennai, somebody is starting from Howrah, both are in the same track. One is in advanced stage, one is in the beginning stage. Both are in the same track. This is what he is saying. So therefore, the context of Bhagavad Gita has to be understood, the adhikari has to be understood. Therefore, it is not a... it is categorized under smriti. It is talking to most of us, it is applicable universally, but it is for the majority of the people. Same Krishna gives the knowledge in the Uddhava Gita later on in Bhagavata. In Uddhava Gita, Uddhava is close friend of Krishna and a devotee of Krishna like Arjuna. To him, when he gives, it is pure sannyasa yoga. He is talking about the greatness of sannyasa, virtues of sannyasa, and why he must become it. Because Uddhava was a qualified person. Uddhava's caliber is different. Therefore, you find we have to be very careful in understanding the smritis. But what is talked about as the law of mind, law of intellect, law of the self-realization and other paths which are governing, that is not going to change. Just as our way of dressing can change, our way of rituals can change. Recently, the whole India is now talking about Jallikattu as a great ritual. Many people think in terms of it as a Tamil culture, etc. What we have to understand is, yes, you may say it is a Tamil culture, but it is an Indian culture. Indian culture as practiced in Tamil Nadu. Don't you celebrate Makar Sankranti here in a different way? It is the theme is the same, but the way of celebration is different. In Gujarat, they fly kites on Uttarayan day. That is the way of celebration, but the welcoming of sun god into the summer solstice on Uttarayan, that is uniform. That is the same. Deepavali will be celebrated slightly differently here as Kali Puja, in North India as return of Rama, in South India as killing of Narakasura, bursting of crackers, various things can be there. But Deepavali theme is the same. The way in which Deepavali will be celebrated is different. Exactly like that, you can take any festival, Durga Puja, Ganesh Puja, various pujas, Holi, Rakhi, Raksha Bandhan, all this, that there is something eternal about the principle. But the way in which it will be implemented will be according to geographical location, according to various circumstances, etc. Like that, the theme of Shruti is the Brahman or Atma Vidya. That is the theme. That theme may be taken up and given to particular audience, particular geographical location. And these are, again, as we said in the last class, smritis are not just written by anybody and everybody. That also needs an expert rishi to write it, and that is how it is given. So, this Upanishad talks about Sanatana Dharma, and it is not dependent on any god, sage or savant or anything. Yet, various philosophers, thinkers from East and West have paid glorious tributes. This may be inspiring for few of us who value it. It is just a way to get a person initiated. Vedanta's glory is not dependent on these tributes. Just as all the scientists may talk great about a certain law, that law gains no more weightage because Newton has spoken about it or somebody else has spoken about it. It stands on its own authority. That is the beauty of it. But for a person who values Newton, for a person who values Einstein, let us say, suppose you say Einstein has said this, Newton has said this, then he will get inspired about it. So you can go through the preface of the book, whoever has it later, you will find that the tributes of Max Müller, Paul Deussen, Schlegel, Gough, William Jones, Victor Cousin, these are all given for inspiration. And amongst Indian sages and saints, Maharishi Aurobindo, he laid much emphasis, and all his writings were replete with Upanishadic inspiration. Swami Vivekananda, and of course the great Swami Ramatirtha. Swami Vivekananda spoke of the universality of Upanishads as being founded on eternal principles, while every other religion dependent upon the life of its founder. If you take, by any chance I am saying, for argument's sake, you take Rama away, Krishna away, Shankara away, still the principles will stand on its own authority. But if you take Jesus Christ away, Christianity will not stand. If you take Prophet Muhammad's advent as a latest prophet away, Islam is bound to collapse. It is a personality-centered, history-centric religion. At a particular point of history, God has sent his son, or God has sent this prophet through whom it will be revealed. That is a very central theme. That is not the theme. Therefore, in strictest terms, we can call our religion Vedantic religion. Hinduism is a name given, and we can be very clear-cut in calling ourselves Hindus. There's nothing wrong about it. Hindu is a name given by the people outside India to those who are geographically living on this side of Sindh, Indus River. That is how it came. Nothing wrong in identifying with that. But in traditional way, it is Sanatana Dharma or Vedantic religion it is. Then the great Swami Ramatirtha will conclude with this. A great, greatest of probably the modern self-realized souls. He says, Swami Ramatirtha claims Vedanta as a religion which is found in the streets, which is written upon the leaves, which is murmured in the brooks, which is whispered in the winds, which is throbbing in your veins and arteries, a religion which concerns your business and bosom, a religion which you have not to practice by going to a particular church or a temple or a mosque, a religion which you have to practice and live in your everyday life, about your hearth, about your dining room, everywhere. This is the, you know, greatness of Ramatirtha. He says, Vedanta is your own, it is found within you. You ask your veins, you ask your arteries, it is speaking Vedanta to you. The entire universe is speaking Vedanta. You only have the ears and eyes to open, to see it, to listen to it. What is being taught to us by nature is pure Vedanta only. So it is there. It is for you to take it up and live it and practice it. So Upanishad is not to be taken as a some external knowledge which is sourced in a book alone. It is the knowledge which reveals the self within you. That is how it is to be taken. That is why we say Vedanta has the other angle to it, that Veda means Vedas, Anta means end. End portion of Vedas is Upanishad. That is the direct meaning, which is correct. But Veda means knowledge. Anta means culmination. Culmination of all knowledge is yourself. Culmination of all knowledge means that having known, you will not need anything else. You have come to know your own real self. That knowledge is called Vedanta. So therefore, Vedanta is the source knowledge within you. You need not search for it anywhere else. It is there within you. So as we study the Upanishad as a text externally, what must be invoked is the spirit internally, the self internally. That is the import of this, what Swami Ramatirtha says. Then, as I said, there are 10 Upanishads which are considered very authentic because great masters have commented on it. The four Upanishads, that is book taken in this book is Kena, Ishavasya, Kaivalya and Mundaka. The three of these four are coming in the 10. Kaivalya is not there, but it is also considered a very authentic Upanishad. The term Upanishad means, Upa means near, Ni means below, Shad means sit. Upa means near, Ni means below, Shad means sit. So therefore, this term Upanishad itself gives, indicates the qualities of the seeker. Upa means you go near to the master. See, nowadays, of course, we have technology. Even Swamiji has recommended e-learning. It is there. Through internet you learn. We use the technology to learn. There's no harm in it. But the real way of learning is to go near to the master, serve him and learn. That is the right way, effective way of learning. Not just Upanishad. We see in various other sources of knowledge also, whether you learn a dance, whether you learn astrology or whatever you are learning, you go near to him and then serve him and then learn from him. That has a different effect or impact. So Upa refers to the physical proximity of the student to the master. Ni refers to below. The student sits below, the master sits above, so that the student looks up to the master. There's an attitude of devotion. So physical proximity is Upa. Mental proximity or mental devotional attitude is represented by Ni. You see, contrast this with the modern, sometimes classroom, even in West, you see that the lecturer is standing and there is an auditorium which is like that, and he is looking up to the students and addressing. That doesn't really gel with the way that why it is, the moment you look up to something, there is a devotion. So that Ni is referring to that. Devotion is a very important aspect of learning this knowledge. And Shad refers to sit. It is a quality of introversion. Sit means you are sitting in a place and not moving, means you are willing to do that tapas. You are willing to do that reflection and contemplation that is required. So a relatively introverted person can relate to Upanishad better. It is not in a hurry-burry rushing here and there that you are, I have 5 minutes, can you tell something about Upanishad? You can't say like that. It won't work like that. It is a quality by which you have time for yourself to sit, reflect, etc. So, a intellectual discipline. So, at the physical level, you are nearer to the source of knowledge. At the mental level, you are devoted to the source of knowledge. At the intellectual level, you are saying yourself that you are prepared by being an introverted person. So the quality of the real seeker itself is given by the term Upanishad. And every Upanishad starts with invocatory mantras. This Keno Upanishad especially has two invocatory mantras. One is specific for Keno Upanishad, one is a general one, Sahana Bhavatu, which is given. So we will begin with the invocatory mantras in the next class. We will conclude with the bhajans here.
Madhava Gopala Keshava Govinda. Madhava Gopala Keshava Jayananda Mukunda Ananda Govinda Radhe Gopala Jayananda Ananda Govinda Radhe Gopala Govinda Madhava Gopala Keshava Govinda Madhava Gopala Keshava Kiri Gopala Keshava Kiri Gopala Keshava पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।